Well, Ravi, it's very interesting. See, I come from a middle class family in Vijayawada. My father is an IT instructor. We are four brothers. I'm the youngest one. I don't know, somehow from childhood onwards, our family has been an Ambedkarite family. So there is no other ideal in our family. It's only Ambedkar. And you know, my father used to, parents used to talk about him a lot. Of course, there is also a little root from my mother's side. My mother's father has been a staunch Ambedkarite. And he was one of the bodyguards who acted as a bodyguard for Dr. B.R. Ambedkar when he traveled in South India in 1944. My mother is from a place called Kovali in West Godavari district near Elor. And my grandfather's mother's father's name is Arjaya. And my father, I was brought up in that atmosphere. And my first entry into the public life was in 1984 when Karanchad atrocity took place. You know, inspired by Dalit Mahasabha, we all gathered in Vijayawada, Gandhi Municipal High School, to listen to Kathi Padma Rao. And unfortunately, that was the place where we were all attacked by the police from all the corners, and Kathi Padma Rao was arrested. So that is when I rather entered into the public life, and then I was also had to suffer a lot of the police lathi charge. Since then, I started thinking, why people treat us like this? What is the reason? So then somehow after my graduation, I came to University of Hyderabad for MSc. I got admission rather in the first list in three subjects: biochemistry, animal sciences, and plant sciences. I was one of the best candidate in the entrance examination. But when I looked at back after one semester, I was one of the persons who is lagging behind in the class, and I failed in one of the subjects. I couldn't understand why it happened, because I've been trying and making my efforts, and in the class performance I stand much better than anybody else. But when it comes to the award of marks by the total internal assessment by the learned professors of the university, I was disappointed and discouraged and surprised. So it continued for 2 years. Then in my second year, when I was taking the national level examinations for GATE and UGC and CSIR, and I got good ranks. I got 97 percentile in GATE, and I was one of the best five in the UGC CSIR national level examination. But when I look back my MSc, I was given only, my total aggregate is 53.5%, and I was not eligible to avail any of these national level fellowships that I could get. So it's another big shock for me. So I said, how do I do my research? I was very passionate to do research in sciences, because I did molecular biology, genetic engineering, all these kind of applied sciences in my MSc. So then I went to Bangalore University. There I was with a professor by name Shetty for about 15 days. And one day when we both walked into your nursery to look at the plants, and there was something the gardener did wrong, and my professor started abusing him by taking his caste name. Then I was really upset. Oh, tomorrow if this fellow comes to know about my caste, and he will also abuse me like this. So immediately I packed up my baggage and left that place. Then I went to Delhi University. I was there in South Campus for some time. I couldn't get any hostel. So again, retreated back to Andhra University. And I was there in Andhra University, botany department for 3 months. And there again, my professor was advising me, try for civil services instead of doing research. Why do you waste your time? You try for civil service. If you don't get civil services, then maybe you can look at research as an option. Because research, if you totally commit to research, nothing will happen. So again, got discouraged in Andhra University, went back to Delhi University South Campus, and I was pursuing my studies. I got a good offer. I submitted my PhD proposal on a gene transformation. It's actually, there is a gene with one of these fungus. It's a very heat resistant gene, and if we can isolate the gene and, you know, transplant it in other organisms, it will be a great revolutionary contribution to the science. So I developed my research proposal, and my professor said, Ravi, you'll have to go to Italy to my professor's place, where you will be trained for some time, because the experiment that you are going to do are very different from the other students are doing. Then I had to look for funds. So I can't fund for myself to go to Italy in those days. And my fellowship, no fellowship has been awarded because of my less percentage of marks in MSc. Then I left my PhD in Delhi University South Campus and tried JNU. And I reached JNU in 1990, got admission to School of Environmental Sciences. So then, before I could actually start going to the university, the Chundur massacre took place in Andhra Pradesh. So started working for the, you know, victims in the hostel in a very small way. Then we found the Chundur victims are coming to Delhi to lodge their dharna. So some few friends, we went and joined them and started working with them and, you know, giving them some solidarity. And the numbers increased over a period of time, because almost a week the Chunduri people camped in Delhi. So our number from 2 to 2, it has gone up to 40 from JNU and, you know, Indian ICR, Pusan Institute. So after Chunduri people retreated back to Hyderabad, Andhra Pradesh, we all got thought, what should we do? Should we do something or not? Then we felt that we should form an organization, a student organization, which can groom us ideologically and also voice the voices of victims of atrocities in Delhi. Because before the Chundur people come to Delhi, the atrocities on scheduled caste people have never become a big news in the country, and, you know, they could never come to go to places like Delhi or, you know, to protest. Then we spent a lot of time, about 3-4 months, we worked day and night, and finally we formed an organization called United Delhi Students Forum in JNU. It was formed in 1990 November. It was the biggest organization. Then we decided there shall be no other organization of scheduled caste students. This is the one and the official organization for all the students, because we, all the students, somehow about 500 people have gathered in a place called Pardsardi Plateau. It's a very historic place for me and a memorable day. We all sat together. We decided that we should form an organization called UDSF. And by that time, our own Dalit students used to have some paper organizations. Some 16 paper organizations such we identified, and, you know, we said, you stop your own personal activism on this and let us do an activism together. So UDSF was formed, and, you know, we thought it was, then we have developed a very preliminary kind of a constitution, and we said the UDSF should work for two fronts. One is for the students of the campus, and also as a organization to voice the voices of the people, victims, scheduled caste victims in Delhi. Then when we looked at the campus, yes, the scheduled caste boys and girls who are coming to the campus, they come from remote rural areas. Their language skills are poor. Their socialization skills are very bad. So we started working on those things, and was to take English tutorials for those who are not able to speak English, and we used to do counseling. And the result was, surprisingly, the suicides or the attempt suicides or, you know, mentally disturbed cases in JNU has suddenly come down. And UDSF become very popular on the campus. And we used to have every Friday week night, we used to have study circle, Ambedkar study circle, where some of us gather and read Baba Saheb Ambedkar's writings and speeches and discuss among ourselves and, you know, develop our own selves. So this is how the life in JNU become very busy, and we have taken up the UGC issue, reservations in UGC JRF fellowships, and reservations in for recruitment in JNU, regularization of. See, by the time when we went to JNU, there was a cadre of staff in JNU who are the sweepers on rolls for the past 17 years, but not regularized. They are on daily wages. Though there are several, you know, SFI, AISF, NSUI, ABBP are all there on the campus, but for them it was never an issue. So UDSF took that issue. We fought with the administration and we got all of them regularized. Now most of them are very happy, and some of them are getting retired now. Those 82 people got regularized, all are class 4 employees. So then in 94, there was a big atrocity in a place called Kumer, which is bordering Delhi in Rajasthan. And we went and, you know, did the fact finding. That was the first fact finding in my life. And the fact finding team, when we went to that place, the district collector, we were asked to stay in the district collector's camp office for a night. They have taken every piece of paper, pen, pencil and everything from us, and empty handed we were allowed to go to Kumer village. And we went there. Luckily we could speak to some people, collected a paper, piece of papers and pens from them, and, you know, did a fact finding. We had developed our own notes, and when we returned to Delhi, we came to know that the scheduled caste parliamentarians are having a meeting in the Constitutional Club, demanding a scheduled caste president for the country. So we burst into their conference and we said, when there is no security for people's life and their chastity, scheduled caste people, we don't want presidents. So we did a kind of small dharna, and, you know, we were invited by K.R. Narayan Garu, and he said, you know, let the boy speak. So one of our friend, Gajendran, who is now in US, has done his PhD from Columbia, he spoke about the Kumer atrocity. Then immediately the parliamentarians forum constituted a 6-member committee headed by Bhota Singh to go to this place and, you know, come with his own report. Ironically, in our report we said 120 people are either got killed or dead, but their report said only 6 people got killed. Anyway, the official reports and, you know, political reports will be different from the actual facts and figures. So that is how the life in JNU became very, very busy, and, you know, I was struggling to do my research. I did my MPhil and I got A+, so one of the distinguished students. But when I went to back to my professor for PhD admission, he denied giving me PhD admission. And he said, you go change the supervisor, I will not guide you anymore. I don't know the reason. It was about, for 3 months I was without a supervisor, lingering around JNU. Then surprisingly, I found in International Toxicology Journal, my MPhil paper has been published without my name and any reference to me, but in the name of my professor. Then I realized the reason for him to kick me out of his lab. Then I started looking for a guide. So it went on for another 6 months, and finally I hooked up to some professor. He is from different background, I was from different background. We were trying to do some work. But somehow I got totally drifted towards the Dalit movement and issues. So I left my PhD in 98 and retreated to Hyderabad and joined an organization, an NGO, International Funding Agency, called Catholic Relief Services, where I was a manager for agriculture. And the assignment was to make a transition from food for work to watershed approach. So I worked hard and I created some 25 model watershed projects in 5-year span in Chhattisgarh region. But still not happy, because it's an American organization where social identities or social issues are not their choice. So I create infrastructure, physical infrastructure without life in it, a social life in it, and through these watersheds. So then I left that and, you know, went to negotiate with other people, and somehow become the secretary of National Dalit Forum, where I started working. And initially, National Dalit Forum is supported by Center for World Solidarity. This kind of support continued till, you know, recently, till 2011. But in 2010, the management in CWS has changed, and their approach towards Dalit has become a totally eyewash kind of a thing, and they stopped funding for NDF. So that is how the funding to NDF also got seized now. So all my colleagues and friends who worked with the NDF, as we are all employees of NDF. But now also we are all actually colleagues. We work more in solidarity, though we are not employees, or though we don't take any salary from NDF, but we have been continuing our activism. And my recent 6 months of stay in Bihar is also an extension of that unemployed activism in Bihar, because the network over there, they said, Ravi, you come over, we'll take care of you, and you extend your support. So the activism is going on. It continues. Only the magnitude might change, but you know, I think the kind of convictions that the experience that from which I emerged, and my colleagues now, if I have to talk about them, each one is a great history. Nonetheless, I should talk about Karthik Navayan, who is now doing his PhD in IFLU. You must be knowing him through his Facebook and his writings on the internet. He pursued his whole studies in a very informal way. He was never into a formal educational institution till he joined IFLU last year for MPhil. So, like that, all of us, Jansi, Karthik, Sunita, Chek, big number to count. Sometimes they are paid workers, sometimes they are not paid workers, they are volunteers, they are solidarity friends. But the mission is continuing. So I'm happy to Ravi and Dalit Camera to talk about, ask me to talk about this. See, the latest thing that we did from 2008 onwards is the focus on special component plan. Many organizations are claiming today that we are party to it. But NDF from 2008 February onwards has deployed all its financial human resources in bringing awareness about this special component plan budget. We have conducted hundreds of workshops across 14 states in India, and we drafted legislation at the national level, and the legislation has been introduced in the Rajya Sabha in 2010 as a private member bill also by one Mr. Aziz Pasha of CPI. Of course, the bill was not discussed because it's a private member bill. It was an example bill. Actually, if the government of India or any group wanted to bring in a legislation or provide status to special component plan, it should be in line with that what we have proposed and placed in the Rajya Sabha. But interestingly, the bill that the Minister of Social Justice and Empowerment has hosted on its website has been a thoroughly watered down bill. So let us see what happens. And we have raised our voice. We have written to the Minister of Social Justice some 100 letters incorporating the left out or areas to be strengthened in their draft bill. We are waiting for the bill to come out. So our mission continuing today, we wanted to strengthen whatever the legislation that has been passed in Andhra Pradesh. See, the Andhra Pradesh government has passed this legislation for providing status to SCP. Is again a watered down one. But see, in a battle, we see it is a battle. In a battle, historically we are the losers. And when very recently we started seeing little victories, and we can say this is one of the a little victory, but there's a lot miles to go ahead. And now we are working out the strategies. How do we strengthen this weak special component legislation in Andhra Pradesh and also work in other states to get similar things? Because the way the present bill hosted by the Minister of Socialist Empowerment, we don't know when it will be placed in the House. So it could be a total political tactic to get the scheduled caste vote bank. Or maybe they are serious. If they are serious or not, it all depends on the kind of bill that they present in the House and make legislation. Thank you.